letter was written January 8th, 1925 to Mr. Johnston at Berry Springs Orphanage Home. And here's what it said. Dear Mr. Johnston, when you were here in the fall, I spoke to you about a family of children whose father is dead and whose mother is an invalid. The mother has tried so hard to keep the children, but the doctors say if she's not relieved of this care of the children, that she will never regain her strength. So if they can be taken in the orphanage until the mother can care for them, I am sure that she will want them back. There are four children from 2 years old to 8 years. And if there ever was a deserving case, this is one. The mother is barely 30, and the last baby was born several months after the father's death. Please find a place if you can. June of that year, I was placed here at the home at Berry Springs. What gets me here, she says, please find a place. Everybody needs a place.
I was raised in an orphanage. And I was proud of the fact I was raised in an orphanage. Now, there may be some that wasn't, you know, but to me, that was a great thing.
Well, I think you have to realize, too, the circumstances that we came from. Our circumstances were bad at home. So this was a great relief to us, really.
The beauty about being in a home like I was, we learn how to make do. We learn how to get along. We learn to take justifiable pride in what we did.
And the institutions have all disappeared. And today, I feel very sorry for kids that are going into these foster homes.
When you talk to somebody, what's their perception of an orphanage? A lot of them think it's being beat on the knuckles, and it's kind of Dickinsonian or whatever.
Lisa, I want some more.
What?
That was not what this was all about here. It wasn't a kid that I went to high school. They can't tell you what the American dream is.
Every year, each year in August, we have homecoming, and we are always here. I think perhaps I've missed 2 years coming back in the 50 years that we've been gone.
Life would be different if I had had a loving family. But I'm not sure that I'd be any better off. In fact, I don't think I would. My mother tried to keep us together the best she could, but she was weak and she didn't know what was wrong with her. They didn't have Social Security and any help for widowed ladies back in those days and their children. We were living behind the Presbyterian church there. I can remember that. And we were sitting on the porch, my sister and I. And this lady drove up in a, like a Chevrolet coupe. I can't remember anybody telling us goodbye. I was four, my sister was three, and she brought us to Berry Springs. She just picked us up and put us in her car, and we just drove off.
I came here in September of 1946. There were almost 300 kids here when I came. They all had a different story. Our family had 9 members. My father's first 2 wives died in childbirth, and then he married a much younger woman, my mother, in the hopes that she would live, I guess. And then she left us when I was about 3 years old. and my father was unable to look after us. He had a third grade education, and he was, I guess what you call a tenant farmer. We lived on the back of someone else's farm. But we were happy, at least I was happy. My father drank, but he was very good to us. He came back one day through the woods carrying a gallon of what they call black strap molasses. He gave me a little taste of it and asked me if I liked it, and I said no. And he put the top back on, went back to the store through the woods, and got a different kind and brought it back. Just to show you how good he was to his kids. We never saw things like cars or anything. And one day a car came down through the field and they put us in it, and we came here to Berryham Springs. And I don't know about my sisters, but I had no idea that we were coming here. And that's how I got here.
Remember that? You don't remember the day, but it was a bad day for us. They came and picked us up with that car.
I remember being picked up.
I know you do. It was a bad day.
I remember being picked up.
Bad day. You were at, what, second or third grade? I was in sixth grade. It was a bad day for you.
I don't have a lot of recollections of a bad day. I do recall the day that you and I were picked up in a car and we were brought here. I remember when they brought us into receiving across the way. I remember that because in my mind, I was kicking and screaming and didn't want to do it.
That's true.
And I wasn't a happy camper, as I recall.
Like everybody, we come from two different perspectives. We come from a second grader to a seventh grader, older brother, younger brother.
The only time we were really ever together here was when they first brought us into receiving for that short period of time, and then we were split.
Your schedule was different, your education was different, you know, your recreation schedule was different. You know, his pathway was different. Now, the result was we both turned out to be pretty responsible people.
There were three of us. I was the middle daughter, three girls. And my mother and dad, they were immigrants. And my father died when I was four. My mother worked. It's very, it's so silly, but after all these years, but I can think of her working with the three little children. Anyway, she did have a nervous breakdown where that she had to be hospitalized, and then they took us away. And fortunately, we went to the Hebrew Orphan Asylum. 1560 Amsterdam Avenue, Manhattan. It was a huge place.
Tremendous.
It looks like a medieval castle. There were 400 girls and 600 boys and four dormitories on the girls' side, about 75 to 100 kids in each dormitory. It started in the 1800s because of children that didn't have a place to go, Jewish children.
I was there from 1926 to 1936 as a child, and then returned as a junior counselor. My mother was on the verge of a nervous breakdown. My father had deserted the family, and we never saw him again. My mother was sent to the country or something to recuperate, and then she came up to visit us, and from then on, she was always there.
You know, most of the kids in the H were not orphans. There were only very few that were deprived of both parents. My mom was away for about a year, and then when she became better, because we saw her whenever she was able to come up.
She was a great lady, her mother. We all knew her, of course, we were all very close.
They all called her mommy, didn't they?
Yep.
Yeah, she was the greatest lady.
There's a difference between an orphanage and being orphaned in the sense that if something happened where your parents couldn't take care of you, somebody made a decision to put you in a different situation. We had never been to a dentist in our life. We we didn't even have shots, for God's sakes. You know, I can remember getting chicken pox. I had whooping cough. Who gets whooping cough in the civilized world? Mom didn't have money for that. Yeah. That was the whole reason why we're here. When we ran the streets, we were in that judge, and we were put here because she couldn't take care of us. No fault of hers. It was tough times, and a lot of people don't realize that. And we were one of the lucky ones that we got picked to come to a place like this. Think about the kids, you know, who didn't have the advantages we had here.
The home goes back to 1865. It was designed for soldiers in the Civil War who had died, and their wives didn't have anywhere to take care of the kids, and they started taking in the dependents of deceased Civil War veterans. And then what happened is the state took it over, as I understand it, and then you got put here like we did. This was to become a surrogate institution for parents who, due to the depression and whatever the reason might be, couldn't take care of you, and they were going to give up on us. That simple. It's hard to have vision, but whoever started this in 1865, group of people, whoever it is, they sure as hell had vision, because it's worked until 79 or whenever it was. As near a home as you could get in the institution.
We came to Connie Maxwell to live because in May of 1946, our house burned down. I was 4 years old at the time. And the following month, my father was killed in a car wreck that left my mother with three boys. We were desperately poor. I don't even know how we lived back in that time because all the money, the paper money, was burned up. And the few coins she had that were melted together, she tried to take them to the bank. I remember that. Matter of fact, we lived in a barn for a number of months, and we slept on corn chucks. We didn't have any bedding. Everything was burned up in the home. We were so desperately poor that that the only thing that we had to eat during that time was cow's milk and a little sugar mixed with it and bread, and that was it. I remember that vividly in my five-year age range there. Our preacher called us all up in front of the church and made an appeal to the congregation. He was going to let us take an offering plate and stand at the door. And when the people came out after the service, anybody wanted to make a contribution to us, they could do so. And in retrospect, I could see where a lot of people say, gosh, that must have been so embarrassing. I don't remember it as being an embarrassing situation. I remember it being something we desperately needed. And if it's like a drowning person, a life buoy means everything if you're drowning. And we were drowning financially. Connie Maxwell was the answer for my family. There's no question about that.
What caused me to come here is the part that I might want to avoid. My mother loved her children. She died and had to go. My grandmother had me. She died and had to go. My sister went off to college. My father was an alcoholic. And I was not so very welcome at all in the home of my aunt and uncle. And that's all I'm going to say about that. So I needed another place. I was glad to come to Connie Maxwell. That's the best suitcase I've ever packed.
I came in 36, when I believe I was five.
I came in 1940, and I was eight.
And she came to bury him when I was down at the infirmary. And see, the infirmary is where you always went first. I guess they checked you health-wise and just make sure, you know, things were okay. And I can remember her coming that day.
He was the first child I met when I went to Barham Springs.
I told her, I said, man, you were white as a sheet when you came. I said, did she a girl ever get out in the sun, you know? So, of course, she had brothers that came with her, you know. But I don't remember the brothers. I just remember her, you know. Anyway, it was quite amusing to think that later, you know, down the road, we would be married. You know? This kind of unique, I think.
When I was growing up at ISSCS, we sort of gave ourselves a nickname because we were from the home. We called ourselves homers. And we would even have some of the kids at high school call us that. We didn't like it when they called us homers. And I can remember at one of our reunions just in the past few years, one of the house mothers came back, and that's what the front of our book said. Homers, right across the top of the book. And this particular house mother held that book up to us as she was speaking, and she said, I can remember a time when the word homers made you kids cry. And now look at you, you're proud of it. And it's the truth. I don't care who calls me a homer now.
If I hadn't have gone to ISSCS, I know I would have ended up on the streets of Chicago and probably would be in prison today. I felt abandoned, completely abandoned. by my father. He's the one that brought us out there to the school. And literally, my brothers even tell me, but of course I was too young at the time, my brothers thought we were stopping at a restaurant and was going to be there just for food. And he pretty much dropped them and then just drove away. I was three or four. They didn't want to take me at first because they didn't take kids that young. One of the cottage parents kind of looked after me, and she said, yeah, I'll watch over Eddie. And it was a real nice experience. She kind of adopted me, and her name was Annie Lou. She would come in with, there was about 12 to 16 kids to that cottage. Every morning she used to walk in and go, upsy-daisy-doo-dum. And to this day, I've even done that to my poor girls. Every time they wanted to, they had to get them up, I'd go in there and say, upsy-daisy-doo-dum. So this day, they're even saying it. People got a negative view of orphanages from all these old movies. You look back at Boys Town and a lot of the movies that were made about orphanages, and I just shake my head and just kind of laugh sometimes at how that was not any way the way it was.
First thing I remember is all the little kids that was there. You know, I was placed at the baby cottage, and there was about 30 or 40 little kids there. And they were all out in the yard playing, you know. And I was kind of overwhelmed with it because I hadn't been around that many children before. And they had a merry-go-round. I'd never seen one. And somebody just took me and put me on that. And I didn't know I had motion sickness then. But the time they whirled me, you know, several times around that thing, I had something coming out of both ends before they could get me off of there. And I thought, oh man, I'm gonna have a tough time here, you know.
When we did first go out to the school, we were in shock because we weren't aware where we were going. And of course, your first impression then is this huge place. I mean, it had all these buildings, and you saw all these children running around, and you're thinking, ooh, I'm gonna be a part of this. Am I gonna fit in? You don't have a choice. You fit in. If you're going to get along, you just seem to fit in.
I didn't like it. I didn't like being here at first. See, I went from, in a very short time, I went from a family of about nine people to essentially a family of one, myself. I was kind of sad up to about when I was about 8 years old. I still had not seen my father since I had come here. And I guess I really missed him a lot. But I was starting to forget what he looked like. One day, a chain gang came down the road that splits the campus. And they were cutting the right-of-way. And they had a guy there with a shotgun on his shoulder, guarding. And I was out at the chain-link fence, hanging onto the fence and looking at this guy. And I'm not sure whether he really looked like my father or I thought he did. But I kept wanting to ask this guy if he was my father. And I was sort of convinced that he might be. But every time I would sort of get up the nerve, I would chicken out because I was afraid these guys would, laugh at me or something. So anyway, somewhere along in there, I started, getting better as far as feeling, you know, down and so forth.
When I was younger, as far as how I felt towards my mother and father, like any other kid, we try to think that they're great people. And I used to meet up all these army stories about my father, how he was in World War II and all this type of thing. And the kids would brag how great their mothers or fathers were, that type of thing. My mother was a beautiful woman. And she used to sing. She did some, she did some vaudeville. And she was very attractive. It wasn't hard to be proud of her. When she did come down, she was a very beautiful woman. And everybody, ooh, whose mother is that? You know, that type of thing. but pretty much lied most of the time, almost to the point they're almost to where you'll believe them. We more or less made up our parents because, you know, really we didn't know them.
I can remember one time I was in downtown Bloomington, and I was walking across the street and I saw my father on the other side of the street. And I told the girl I was with, of course, we always traveled in pairs. So I told my friend I was with, there's my father. And she goes, oh, it really is? And I said, yes. And she says, do you think he'll recognize you? I said, I don't know. And he walked right by me and walked across the street and didn't know who I was. I don't know what I'd have done if he'd have said something. I probably would have panicked. But it was sort of like, wow, he didn't even know me.
There was one kid here that, when he was very small, I think he was 4 or 5 years old, his mother sat down on the front porch and she put a shotgun in her mouth and had him to pull the trigger. And I wondered, you know, like, what became of him later when he got old enough to realize what he'd done. And just some things like that that, you know, make me realize how fortunate I am. Like I say, just not having anything bad happening to you is good enough for me. I mean.
My daddy never visited me except when I graduated from high school. My brother and my sister told him he had to come. And it was fine. I went to see my dad in the summer when we had vacations. He was always kind to me. He was good to me. He was never abusive to me at all, even when he was alcoholic. It's just that I think he couldn't get over the fact that he did not provide for me. Then I came to campus. And I saw Dr. Smith as just had every characteristic that I would like to copy. So I have tried to mold my life in that way, hoping I have captured one or two of his characteristics. Dr. Sam Smith told me one time, you can do anything you set your mind to do. And I believed him. I probably have 50 letters Dr. Smith wrote to me over the years, telling me, you know, that he was proud that I had done well. And he didn't do that just for me. I don't know how he had enough time. He did it for everyone.
He was the number of kids' light at the end of the tunnel. I was unhappy the first year. I was just an unhappy camper. And I decided I'm going to get enough nerve one day to run away. And so I snuck out one night and stuck my thumb up and got a ride and went all the way back to Greenville, South Carolina. Took me about an hour and a half, and I was kind of sheepish. I went to my old house where Dad was. I didn't know what would happen. I didn't know if I was going to get my butt tore up or I was going to, you know, get chewed out. I didn't know what might happen. In the process of that, I went back up to the house and presented myself, and I did get chewed out, and I did get my butt beat, and Dr. Smith came to Greenville, and I got in his car, and he seemed like he was pretty sad that I had run away, and he drove me back to Greenwood, and he asked me why I'd run away, and I just very bluntly and very adamantly told him I didn't like Connie Maxwell and I didn't want to be here and I run away and I might run away again. At any rate, he brought me back and was very soft and very easy and very gentle. He patted me on the leg and he acted like he was upset that I was upset. He was a man that really influenced my life greatly.
Our experience at Barham Springs would not be told without mentioning the superintendent of the home when we were here, Joseph B. Johnston. He was like a father to everybody.
He guided my life. There was things I wouldn't do and never did on account of his teaching. I never did smoke. I never did drink any kind of alcohol. It was just my choice, you know, and it still is. And I don't feel bad toward anybody else that does. That's their choice. And this is the way it was in the Army, too. They would make fun of me and all, but it didn't bother me.
He amazed me. Now, remember that we had 300 children here at one time, and he could go down that alphabet and list every child's name by memory. Not by reading, but by memory. He was special, and every child knew he was special in his eyes.
Time, time, time is winding up. Time, time, time is winding up. Time is winding up.
Mr. Johnston took us to see our mother one time before she died.
I was probably not over 6 years old. And Mr. Johnston put me in the front seat with him. He was a big man. He was probably 6'6", had a big head, and he played football for Davidson College. And he had one of those hats with a rim on it. What do you call those? Fedora. And it was a nice one, you know. He wore the best hat there was, and he wore it all the time. Every time you see a picture of him, he'd have it on. Well, he took off his hat, he was hot, and set it over in my lap, you know, for me to hold it. Well, we got down the road and got to going around curves and one thing to another, and man, I was getting sicker all the time. I wasn't about 5 years or 6 years old, I think. And all at once, I had to heave, and I just filled his hat up with what I'd heaved out. Man, he didn't take us back down there anymore.
Dr. Jameson was our superintendent. He was a gym dandy, spick and span. Every fall, he would go around in the area, South Carolina, associational meetings, and he made this a basic statement everywhere he went. He said, "Now, gentlemen, I appreciate what you people are doing for Connie Maxwell, but there's one thing I want to make crystal clear. We do not accept used clothing." He said, "Some of my kids have one strike against, some have two. None of them are going to have a third strike against. Every stitch of clothing, every shoe I put on was brand new." And I appreciated that to him. God bless him.
My first cottage parrot, we affectionately called her Miss Mac. Her name was McDonald. She really taught me so very much. All my ethical background, all my character, dependability, the honesty, all my attributes, that if I have any. She really pounded those principles into me, and I appreciate that very much. Ms. Hilton was the second cottage parrot I had. She was my mother figure after I left Miss Mack. She bragged on every one of us to anyone that would listen to her. She absolutely tried to find something good in each one of her girls.
But of course, everything in life is good and bad. In those days, I think they couldn't afford to pay the staff too well. And occasionally, you get a bad apple, you know.
When I was probably 12, 13 years old, I lived in Logan Cottage. And I'm telling you, this house mother, she just did not like me. She seemed okay at first, because, you know, you're new and she's, you know, welcoming you in with her little group, but she got mad at you. That was it. You were not on her list anymore. So I think I became a little rebellious living at Logan, but she won out in the end. She reported Judy, my best friend, and I to the front office, and we were put on medication three times a day, 50 milligrams of phenobarbital. And I can remember that winter, and it seems like it was in about maybe the winter of 63. We slept almost the whole winter because of those tablets that we were taking. Towards the end of the winter, we would plead with our social workers and the nurses, please take us off of these. Well, they finally did, you know, well, are you gonna behave? So we did sort of behave a little bit. And so finally they did cut the dosage down. Personally today, I felt that she had no business being a house mother.
Well, shortly after I got here, there was a young boy in my class, and he got appendicitis, and his matron wasn't a nurse. So she gave him the worst thing she could have given him, unbeknownst to her. She gave him a dose of paregoric. You don't give a dose of paregoric to anybody who has appendicitis. So it made his appendix burst. So they had to pack him in ice. And he was in my same grade. In fact, he was sat in the seat right beside me. And he just lingered on life and death, life and death. Finally, he died. And he's buried in the cemetery right up there by the administration building. That shook me up.
They would never be in charge today of children because they were just not qualified. Not that they were bad or mean or anything like that, they just didn't know how to handle children. And from this perspective, looking back, kind of feel sorry for them.
I don't ever remember being really abused or something stands out in my mind that I was overhit, overpunished, or that type of thing. You know, they used to crack our knuckles with the ruler or a little crack on the head or a twist on the ear and, you know, and a spanking when we needed it.
Now, that you might not like them because if they're the ones that give you a whap in the fanny or they're the ones that assigned you to wash windows or the ones that tell you couldn't go to the movie on Saturday, you're not going to like that as a kid. But when you get older and you raise children, like my seven girls and my grandchildren, with it, you realize they were really doing me a favor. When I came here, no, I didn't realize that. I was a pain in the ass. And they've got records to prove it if I ever said different than that. I was violent. I hadn't been to school very much. I used to go and eat, steal stuff out of grocery stores to eat. I slept in bowling alleys. The police picked me up. Why do you think we got here? No, I didn't realize that. Now, as an old man, well, I sure appreciate it now.
Winter came on there at the baby cottage, and one of my little buddies, little Paul, he got a earache. Well, the house mother said, little Paul, I'm gonna give you a hot water bottle tonight. Well, little Nelson thought, man, I'd like to have one of them hot water bottles, you know. So I waited, I thought it wouldn't be too suspicious. And so I told the house mother, I said, I got a earache. She said, well, little Nelson, you get a hot water bottle tonight. Man, that night I got my hot water bottle. I hugged that thing. I had it on my neck. I had it on my back. I put it on my feet. I loved that hot water bottle, you know. I want you to know the next morning, Mr. Johnson come driving up in his A-model Ford. He came into baby cottage. He got little Paul and little Nelson, put us in the A-model Ford, took us to Statesville to Davis Hospital and had a consult took out. And there wasn't even nothing wrong with me. The moral was that, brother, if you better tell the truth as long as you stay in this place, or they're gonna cut something out of you. So I'm pretty honest with them.
One of the things I think that stands out in my mind that was a real growing experience for me, when I first left, I stayed 3 years at Eastern Star Cottage. And the cottage mother and I, she was a good cottage mother, but we just did not get along. She was a strict disciplinarian, and I didn't cotton to that real well. I went to Dr. Smith, who was a superintendent at the time, and asked him if he would move me to the chicken farm. That was kind of considered a little sissy job. You know, it wasn't the other jobs I really wanted. At any rate, one Easter, the farm manager at a local farm and garden center store in Greenwood, just after Easter, came to Dr. Smith and says, we've got about 450 or 500 little teeny tiny Easter chicks. We have dyed them red and blue and green and brown and purple and every other color imaginable. Do you want them? And Dr. Smith kind of realized that I might fit into that wanting those chickens. It was a rewarding experience for me to see them grow. They would imprint on humans. They'd follow you around just like a dog follows, you know, his mother. And I think I must have, I'd have to get up maybe 4, 5, 6, 7 times a day and go out and feed them and check them and make sure they're all right. Well, every time I'd go in the chicken house, they would follow me. Just, I mean, 400 or 500 of them just had to get right under my feet. They grew up, we killed them and sent them around to the homes and had some fried chicken out of all of that.
My favorite coat hangs in the hallway, waiting like a good friend.
My freshman year in high school, I moved to a cottage down Girls Row a little ways, and that house mother was wonderful. I mean, it was just like night and day. And even to this day, I mean, some of my fondest memories are of her, because she truly cared about us and we knew it. We had something about every house parent that we could make fun of. What was so funny about her, it was always something about trying to be a lady, or I'm gonna make a ladies out of you girls if it kills me. And some of us, she did her job. She made ladies out of a lot of girls.
My favorite coat hangs in the hallway, waiting like a good friend to keep me.
That's where the TV was when we learned John Kennedy died. We were all laying here on the floor. And there was a couch there, a couch here. I think we had one here. And when you've got 15 girls, you need a lot of couches. And the house mother's desk was set right there. So every day you came in from school, you went right to her desk first for your mail or what, I don't remember now, but she always checked there to see if you had any messages or. It does really bring back memories.
Is washing us clean.
I mean, good ones.
Me and my coat.
I think the one thing I found that the restriction was quite severe compared to where I'd come from. We were allowed to run the streets, being a youngster. I'm sure that's why I was plucked from where I was and put where I was. But then to go out there and you weren't allowed to do anything without asking permission.
The girls had it a lot rougher than what we did. You know, the boys, I guess they kind of had a little bit of freedom, but the girls were very, very protected.
We were never allowed to go anywhere by yourself. The girls were not. You always had to go with your cottage, usually. When we got into high school, you were allowed to go off the grounds, but you had to go with someone else. You were never allowed to go by yourself.
I used to sneak smoking when I was in the home. I was only a kid. This one time, I left my cigarettes in my smock pocket. Miss Franco had a habit of poking in the kids' lockers. And sure enough, when I came home, my cigarettes were gone. And I'm waiting for the repercussions, but nothing happened. Nothing happened. Years later, when I was leaving, she said, Annie, she said, go up to my room. I have something of yours in this drawer. And I went up to her room, and in the back of her drawer, there was that pack of cigarettes that she had taken, never told on me.
Now, the matrons, we had respect for them. They worked hard, and they really cared for us, but they wouldn't hug you and kiss you or nothing. They just, maybe they thought they didn't have time. That was a different time then, and people didn't show their emotions too much. I can't remember really any teacher or a house mother or anybody that ever hugged me while I was here.
I had a very difficult time showing love and compassion to my children because I was never given love or shown love or compassion. When you grow up with that many little girls, it's very difficult for a matron to give that much love out to all these little girls. So there wasn't a lot of that. If you fell down and scraped your knee, you were told to get up, brush it off, and go on. There was no crying. Or they said, stop your crying, it doesn't hurt that bad.
I think that's one of the things that people wonder about, where you got your warmth and where you got your caring. And we got it from each other rather than from the people who were in charge.
Oh, I had a couple of sweethearts while I was here. One was named Inez White, beautiful girl. I guess she's still beautiful, I hadn't seen her in a long time. And we were not allowed to date. So she lived in a cottage way down there, and I lived over here. And the church was over there, and we had morning worship. And she'd be coming down the sidewalk in front of the school building, and I'd walk up there and meet her, and I'd hold her hand going on up to church. And then after that was over, I couldn't walk all the way to her cottage. I walked down to a certain place there. But there was a street light up there, and there was a shade tree. So we'd get under that shade tree to hug and kiss and whatnot. But that was the extent of my love life on campus.
We had what we call tunnels. The school was built, and when it was built, they built these tunnels that were I'd say they're about 6 foot high. And guess what? They interconnected all the cottages and all the buildings throughout. And you know, we used to up to Girls Row, go through these tunnels and meet our girlfriends in these tunnels or over in their cottages. They all connected. And the girls were just great. A bunch of sweethearts, they really were.
I think the one thing that has made me feel like I'm as proud to be an alumnus of Connie Maxwell Children's Home is I hold a Guinness Book of World Records. I've got the most brothers and most sisters of anybody in the whole world. We probably had 325, 350 children on campus. All of us were here, and we knew that we were here because of some bad circumstances. Some had mothers and fathers in prison. Some had mental problems. Some had drug problems. Some had problems where there was severe abuse in the home. Those conditions kind of brought us together as common brothers and sisters.
They are my extended family. There was one child, Patricia. She and I had as big a case of sibling rivalry as any family could ever have had. She would say, I claim the funny paper first on Sunday, you know. She claims this, she claims that. She claims first dive on the diving board. We were constantly trying to see who could win. And the one thing we did not have any competition on Mother's Day, I claimed the white rose and she claimed the red. The white rose you wear if there's a death of the mother. The red if the mother is living. On Mother's Day.
We kind of banded together with some of the parents came and were unruly or you know, been drinking or something. After the parents had left, we'd help each other and kind of console each other.
My father would just show up unannounced. He would, I guess, get a little too much to drink, and one day he would get on a Greyhound bus, and he would show up unannounced here with a white shirt on, showing he had prepared, and he would have snuff all over his shirt where he'd, you know, like, spit, and it would blow back on him or something like that. I would be highly embarrassed when I was, particularly a young teenager, but I realized that he, you know, people when they drink, they do what they want to do, and that showed that he wanted to come see me. Yeah. So I was able to appreciate that.
That's the main thing that Mr. Johnson did, was made a family out of it. He really loved sports, and he had a little football team. Everybody got to play, and we'd play orphanages all over this state as well. Playing together, that's what makes you love each other. And here it was, we was barren against the world. And the people that would play us say, no one of them have such a good team, said, them little orphans ain't got no mamas and daddies. You know, that's what made them so good. But that was a compliment.
Family is is always family, and a child will always defend its own biological family to a certain extent. I heard that when I was here on campus. But our family here is the finest that there could be. And the thousands and thousands of lives that have been redirected here from shattered homes, it's amazing.
One point, I think my dad asked me if I wanted to come home. Well, when he asked me that, I said, well, where's home? You know? I hadn't seen you at any particular place too long, you know. And I said, no, I said, you know, I'm pretty happy right here, you know.
I think it was just a great, great life. I mean, I understand that that it's considered a bad thing now to have children work, but that really was one of the best things about it. Working with the other kids, talking to them, joking around, that really sort of took the work out of it, I guess you'd say.
They sent me to Lee's Cottage, which was truck farming, and truck farming is raising vegetables. And we had fun out there. These guys at the dairy, they had to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, every day in the year. I don't see how they did it, to tell you the truth. And I didn't see how then. They milked anywhere from 80 to 100 cows twice a day. And there's one of the old guys that's here now, Chief Freeman. He'd probably come to homecoming. He can tell you the name of every one of those cows right now. And he's older than I am.
One day, some boys had been dehorning cattle, which is something the ones that worked at the dairy did periodically. When the calves would reach a certain age, their horns would begin to grow out of their head, and we took these things. It sounds cruel, but basically you put them on there and it undercuts them and cuts the buds out, and they never grow horns, but there's an artery in there, and when you do that, it squirts blood, a stream of blood up in the air. You get blood all over your clothes. One day some boys had been doing that, and they had gone back to their building. They saw a substitute house parent, and they decided to pull something on her, since she didn't know them very well. She came down the sidewalk, at which point one boy grabbed his chest and fell over and said, oh, I've been stabbed. And of course, the woman almost had a heart attack.
I like to be water boy. That was my favorite job, because I'd take my bucket and make it like it was going after water, and I'd climb trees, I'd wade in the creek, I'd turn the rocks over and look for crawdads and catch minnows and build little dams, you know, and just have a good time, because I knew when they got thirsty up on the hill, they'd start hollering, you know, water boy, water boy. Our supervisor was a high school boy. You wouldn't believe how hairy he was. He'd take off his shirt, he'd look like a gorilla. Thick hair. And we called him Fuzz. I heard them hollering. I grabbed my bucket and dipper and headed for the spring, 16 spring. I started to reach down in the spring to get some water, and it was a snake curled up in that terracotta pipe. I threw my dipper and bucket down, and I headed back to the bean patch. When I got there, old Fuzz said, hey, farmer, said, where's the water? I said, Fuzz, I couldn't get no water. He said, why not? I said, there's a snake in the 16th spring. He said, listen, said, you get back down there and get some water. I said, that snake's just as scared of you as you is of it. I said, Fuzz, if that snake's as scared of me as I am of it, that water ain't fit to drink anyway.
We would basically go in the woods to play. And once you got in the woods, you were completely free. You could do anything you wanted to, no supervision. And that was one of the best parts of being there. We always had lots of kid power. There was one area that had a lot of young trees, and we would send kids up the tree until it would get heavy enough it would start bending over, and then other kids on the ground would hold it, and then everybody would get off but one kid. And then you'd turn loose of the tree, you know, and kind of fling him into the next county.
We knew that County Maxwell had sold the timber rights, all the nice pine trees, to this company. And they were cutting the timber and had this lumber curing in the field. So we started dropping some of those big, nice, tall pines ourselves, and we built a log cabin that was complete with windows and doors except for one plank. So we decided to go over there one Saturday and get some of that lumber that had been cut and drag it through the woods and use it on our log cabin. So we did. And on this particular day, one of the guys had a camera and took a picture of the log cabin with all of us sitting around in front of it. And somehow Dr. Smith saw that print. And knowing that we had taken lumber off of the lumber mill, he made us a school morning to get up, put on our work clothes, go over there, take that roof off, drag that lumber back through the woods, put it back on that stack, come back, take a bath, get dressed, and get to school on time. It's probably a pile of rot now.
This is the cornfield started right where it is, right, starts right now. And that's the place in the wintertime when you go out of here and you had nothing else better to do. One of the favorite things was we'd get a stick, a big stick, and we'd dress up five or six of us, and we'd go out and on foot and we'd chase down rabbits. Literally, and then Mom Robards would cook the rabbits for us.
When I was at Lee's College, you didn't have to take a bath unless you wanted to, you know. Sometimes I wouldn't take a bath for a week at least. And when you took a bath, man, it made that water dirty. Well, me and Paul McKenzie and Bob Bosworth, that was my little buddies there, we were taking a bath at the same time. Might have been in the same tub, I don't know. But anyway, when we got out, it was cold, winter time. Well, the halls didn't have any heat in it, just a dressing room. And so we'd all run to the dressing room to try to get close to the radiator. Well, Paul, he got ahead of us. He ran on in there and wouldn't let us up there, you know, and he had a radiator, and he got up there close to the radiator. And about that time, he burned his thing, you know, on the radiator. He got... And old Bob started laughing. Well, I knew old Paul, he was quick-tempered. I thought, goodness, I meant it like I wasn't laughing, about to pop. And I stuck my head in the locker where he couldn't hear me. And old Bobby, he's standing there laughing. Old Paul just beat him up, you know, because he was laughing at him. When I was at Lee's College, that was the best part of my, when I look back of it and think about it, of my life. I mean, even now when I think about it, it was.
I don't think this kind of a home will happen again, though.
No, all the people that supported us are gone.
Are gone, and I don't see other people coming up with situations like that other than the city or the government or something in that nature, and I don't think those... To me, I feel that those homes wouldn't be, well, of course, they can never live up to ours. And I think children deserve that. They deserve, you know, not to be lacking things. They should be feel secure as we did.
Being in a home like I was, we learned to be appreciative of small things, little things. I feel sorry for the children of today. All the things that we did back there made me what I am. These children are not exposed to it. They don't know what a dairy is. They don't know what it is to milk a cow. They don't know what it is to go out there and shovel manure out of the shed. But I do. Been there, done that.
Once we graduated eighth grade from ISSCS, we went to high school off grounds. And I think a lot of us felt like we didn't belong there. I mean, our yellow buses pulled up every morning and we all unloaded. And I mean, everybody knew the ISSCS kids were here. And even when we were late or the buses broke down or something happened, I mean, there we all are hauling in the big old yellow buses because it took two buses to take us to school.
We knew we were different because we lived at a children's home. We didn't want a lot of people to know that when we got to school. We just didn't say that where we were from a lot at school.
I had one instance where I almost said something right out loud. I was in a class and the teacher had read something in the newspaper about somebody that had killed their child. And something, and it had to do with because otherwise she'd have to put the child in a children's home. And the teacher was saying, I would do the same thing. I felt like getting up and telling her, do I look that bad? Does you didn't even know I came from a home. You know, I didn't say it though, because I didn't.
You were a child, why, how could you have the nerve to say it?
I wouldn't have the nerve, that's true. But I thought to myself how ignorant that woman was to say something like that.
The elementary school sat right in front of where I'm standing now. It's torn down too. And that's where we had our graduation services. When the high school graduated, we would meet there in the evening in the elementary school. There was a basketball court there, and they would set up chairs, and they'd have enough room for all the kids and everyone. And when I came out, some of them had their mothers and dad, or not mothers and dad, but had their people there, that's what we called them. Some of them did have one mother, or you know, had a mother or dad. But there was nobody there for me. And
of us have a place where we belong. Could be a sidewalk crack or a sad song. Inside our searchings is desire to make a tender heart know.
I can remember leaving the school with such a horrible feeling, thinking I wanted to go. And in fact, I graduated in 3 years so I could leave early. But when that time came, it was a whole different story. It was very frightening. I think I could almost say it was the same type of feeling that I had when I first came, the same frightening experience.
It was a sad time for me. See, it was just like dropping in a hole somewhere. Like, this is my life, you know. And there was nothing. If I just had somewhere, you know, somebody that wanted you, that you could work, that you could, on something you could do, and that the skill you'd have that you could do it with, and you know, make good a good living, I just didn't have it. And that was one of the bad things about the home.
I just asked them to go ahead and draft me. Partly so I wouldn't have to worry about it later, but partly, mostly because I had to go somewhere. So I went into the Army, and then I ended up going to Germany. I was a nuclear weapons technician, assembled nuclear weapons every day. And it really, I mean, you can imagine, since I was 4 years old, I was with all these kids, and one day I'm not.
Now, if I wasn't going to college, you know, I don't know where I would have gone either. I really don't. But since we got a scholarship, we were going to play football at Catawba. And because I know I've heard some of the others talk and say, you know, they didn't know where they were going.
Well, we just learned to take things as it came. We just took it as stride. We didn't question anything. The newspapers had always fascinated me. So I used to go down to the Atlanta, Georgia newspaper just to hang around. It was owned by William Randolph Hearst. I helped make him a millionaire because I worked on his newspaper. Well, anyhow, one of the superintendents asked me, said, Joe, would you like being a copy boy on Saturdays? I said, yeah. How much does it pay? He said, $9. Well, man, I thought he was talking about John D. Rockefeller. $9 back in those days was a heap of money.
The biggest disadvantage is how to integrate yourself into the outside world. When I was 18, the first or second day I was home, my mother asked me to go down and get some milk. And I was hysterical because I didn't know what to do. Where do I go? And what do I do? And I was 18. It was a simple matter of going down to the store and getting milk, and that frightened me terribly.
Fear had a lot to do with everything that I did the rest of my life. and how I think I handled myself. I know that leaving the grounds, going by myself, I'd never been by myself before. I was very lucky because I had a gym teacher who'd encouraged me to go on to college. She said that with my grades, she knew I could get a scholarship. She and her roommate took me in, and I lived with them for several months when I first got out of school. I don't know what I'd have done had they not been there. I really don't.
Mr. Johnson got me a job in Charlotte on a milk truck that delivered milk to door, you know? And my job was to get in the back of that thing. When he stopped, he'd holler back there, 2 quarts, and I'd run it and put it on the porches there in Charlotte. And I don't know if you know what milk smelled like. And my goodness, I was throwing up the back of that truck. I couldn't stand it. But I stayed as long as I could, which was about a week. Got out in time to ride and came back to bear.
And I ended up in a little diner there in Stafford called Trapman Cafe. And I was standing there one day, and about that time, the door opened, and I thought somebody fell out of heaven. And there stood my wife, you know. That was the most beautiful girl I'd ever seen in my whole life. And it was love at first sight. Now, she said it wasn't love at first sight for her, but I won her over in time.
Thing under the sun.
Most of us had very good lives, very average lives. You worked, got a job, married, had children, grandchildren, and you had friends, and no better and no worse than than most people in the world.
The job I had most of my life was at Carnation Milk Company. I was a laboratory technician there for 40 years full-time and 3 years part-time. And I'd come home and tell my wife, you know, honey, they can't run that place without me. She'd say, oh, hush, that they can. But I'd say, honey, they just can't run that place without me. And I want you to know when I retired, to shut the place down. And so.
There's an odd place on this campus, still on the main road, that when my car comes to the very bottom of that road, my whole attitude changes, my mind changes. Everything about me, almost like I'm home. You'd think somebody that had been raised at a children's home like me would not get that feeling because I didn't have a home. This is my home.
I used to refer to the homes that I'd been in as homes for the underprivileged. But looking back on it now, I thank them. I feel like I was privileged to have been here.
The end result, of course, was wonderful, that you come out with the best friends, like an extended family, and never wanting for anything. Except parental love, maybe, but never wanting physical things.
When somebody asked me, Joe, do you have any regrets about living in a children's home? I said, good Lord, no. I can't consider myself blessed that I would happen to be one that was selected to go. I'm far better off. Not only during the time we were here, but all the rest of through life.
That's the thing about being here. You know, you had a place. And I think when that happens to a person, these other things are falling in place. You see? The things of life. Of a job, of a family, of marrying the right person, of living the right life. Life is it's really simple if you think about it. You have to have principles.
and stick with them. And don't be judgmental. People got problems out there, and you just don't know what they're all up against. It gives you another outlook on a person when you know what he's up against. You know? Life is simple, really, but it's hard to get anybody to understand that.
Stone. How can we hide from the blaze?